I would like to extend my personal welcome to all, although I have already chatted with many of you. Long before this function, and some other time period. This function is unfamiliar territory to me because it is focused on me. I'm more used to speaking about issues affecting political, social, and community organizations. I must say I've been blessed with good health for the better part of my life, apart from occasional ups and downs that are almost inevitable in life. This has allowed me to be active in various phases of Zimbabwe's politics from an early age. From my days in the youth movement, passing through the turbulent period of the armed struggle, and lately in post-independence politics. As you all know, I'm current president of ZAPU. At last year's Congress, I was re-elected as president for my second term and last term, because the ZAPU Constitution says there's time limits. You can only be president of ZAPU for 2 terms and not more. And I don't intend to challenge the Constitution, the ZAPU Constitution, in any way, like I've seen other people do. I took the opportunity to remind party members that our constitution has a limit of 2 presidential terms and that I would therefore serve only until 2020 at its third Congress. Happily for me, this will be just after my 80th birthday and a good time to make way for new leadership. On reflection, it became clear to me that there is a need to prepare mentally and to plan for life after full-time politics. Friends and political allies at first were surprised about my resolve that the party has to start thinking of looking for a new leadership instead of waiting until the last minute. In the meantime, I'm doing everything and will continue to serve ZAPU until we secure a meaningful stake in a post-28 elections, if they do take place at all. I was 24 years when I first participated in what was considered an act of civil disobedience under Rhodesian law. I went on with thousands of others to join the liberation struggle to fight for a better future for us all, a better Zimbabwe for future generations. We all know that Zimbabwe, the Zimbabwe we fought for, both our sons and daughters, brothers and sisters, mothers and fathers died for, has only been partially attained. My party, ZAPU, is also a founder member of the coalition of Democrats called, although we delayed our formal accession until we could secure a mandate from our structures, which was last year. We committed then, as we still are today, to a coalition that could bring all significant political parties to fight elections together and bring a new dispensation to replace the disastrous control of the country by ZANU-PF. Where there was only quota, there are now three coalitions of opposition parties, actually driven by competition for who shall sit at the top of the pile. I'm determined that the transition to a better Zimbabwe should not be derailed by me being drawn into power struggles centered on big elephants. As someone reminded me recently, one of the Mozambican leaders used to say, leaders come and go, but the people remain. I'm sure that our people's desire for a better future will outlast any jumbos, but I hope that the people's dreams can come sooner through patriotic attitudes in inter-party and inter-coalition negotiations. Let me now return to the personal level, which is the main objective of the function this morning. The Dumiso Tabengwa Foundation is something that has grown slowly in my mind as I pondered over how I can make a difference and at the same time prepare for life after politics. I've reached the conclusion that there surely must come a time when one returns to normal life and has a time to look back and put something back into society while disengaging from dependency on political office of one kind or another. The foundation therefore allows me a soft landing, but also takes care of my desire to tell and reflect on the story of my life and that of my comrades who shared experiences in various situations. My generation was shaped by the liberation struggle. We had to respond to challenges and requirements of waging a war imposed by the intransigence of racist colonial regime. In most cases, we did not have the luxury of fully documenting our experience as we escalated the armed struggle beyond what we could have imagined at its inception. The roles played by individuals and the fate of those who paid the ultimate sacrifice were not adequately documented. Through the foundation that we are launching today, I hope to contribute to the gathering and preservation of the recent and living history of our struggle. There is significant memory that can be tapped in a way that only those who lived the events can tell. In some cases, there are family members and associates that have untold accounts from those who have passed on. These sources need to be tapped and properly documented while the trail is still fresh. I am confident the foundation can and will embark on this urgent task as soon as it is fully operational. The armed struggle that ended when we attained independence was the most intense phase of a political struggle for freedom and democracy. The professionalization of war sometimes obscures the fact that it was a means to an end and not an end in itself. It will soon be 40 years since we laid down arms at the end of the Liberation War. Yet, a culture of high-handed command and low public participation in decision-making prevails in political, social, and our economic life. There is, therefore, a lot of work to be done to reinforce the supremacy of the people in whose name the war was fought. One of the urgent tasks is to increase voter awareness, particularly among the youth and disadvantaged segments in society, because they may become more and more cynical and apolitical when they lose hope and faith in the electoral system and in us as political leaders. The Foundation will work tirelessly on a non-partisan basis and lobby government and other stakeholders to adhere to constitutionalism and democratic accountability. The end of the Liberation War signaled the end of fighting on the war front, but only the beginning of another struggle for many survivors. For a start, many war veterans fell in the cracks, and their welfare was therefore neglected or simply inadequate. This meant that the welfare of children, widows and widowers of such war veterans needed more attention. Victims of political violence that has continued even after independence need humanitarian aid apart from justice. Immediate needs of the people affected by political violence and its long impacts on social networks, livelihoods, and individual health are areas in which the Foundation will work with others to redress this situation. The liberation struggle was fought on many fronts, principally the political and armed struggle. Armed struggle was preceded and accompanied by massive repression, which saw large numbers of people incarcerated, with or without judicial process, for long periods under the Rhodesian regime. There is need for lobbying so that the state includes all deserving and previously neglected, but deserving persons that have not received attention because of either insufficient awareness of entitlement or inadequate documentation. I now wish to turn to the dark side of our history, not today's. Avoiding painful and unpleasant facts will not make them go away. What we ignore and downplay as a country will grow into a cancer, one that will eat at the fiber of our society and keep us from moving together as one nation. The atrocities of the early 1980s, in which over 20,000 unarmed people were killed in army operations in Matabeleland and the Midlands, which targeted mainly the Ndebele-speaking people cannot be wished away. The foundation will add its voice to those calling for official acknowledgement and acceptance of responsibility. Such a move from the state will open the door to reconciliation and healing and signal willingness to learn from expensive mistakes of the past. If only they can be men enough to do that. The Dumiso Dabema Foundation will seek to mobilize means of assistance to any citizen experiencing political persecution and support the rule of law. The foundation will contribute to the uprooting of ideologies that promote prejudice and bigotry of any kind in our country, that extol violence as a means to protect their stay in power. Turning to the youth, which is going to be one of the main focuses of this foundation. The youth are the future. This statement has never been truer than it is in Zimbabwe today. Over 60% of our population is under 35 years of age, with 40% estimated to be below 15 years. This is a tremendous opportunity for Zimbabwe and a huge responsibility for the elders amongst us, whose responsibility is to lead by example. Personally, I had the privilege of being under the arm of great men like my grandfather, Umubi, and my father, Umavalaji, and political giants like the late Joshua Nkabo Nkomo, who inspired and facilitated my growth. This is a challenge and a responsibility for all mature women and men. The foundation will facilitate the mentoring or reorientation of youth, both men and female, through the planned programs and partnerships. The objective will be to ensure an inspired and empowered youth ready to assume leadership and build a better Zimbabwe. At this moment in time, one of the most important tools for youth will be to assess their rights and their power as a bloc, is to register as voters in their large numbers. I realize quite a number of parents here. Please, let's get our youth to register in their big numbers. Whatever happens to the conduct of elections in one episode should not leave you unprepared to fight for free and fair elections. Your vote is your biggest weapon when that time comes. In conclusion, I want to conclude by emphasizing that the most important and powerful position in Zimbabwe is not that of president. The most powerful position is ours, the people of Zimbabwe. I urge everyone to exercise that power, to find positive ways, no matter how small, to help build our nation. I encourage you all to engage with the Dalai Foundation, join us, offer us your advice and expertise in your criticism. Volunteer. I've humbly served Zimbabwe for 60 years. I'm grateful for that opportunity. With your help and the help of my family and children, I intend to continue to serve Zimbabwe more effectively through this foundation. I thank you.